Hello, my name is Akshat and my topic was thread and process scheduling in Linux operating system. So first of all, I would like to say what is I would like to tell what is process and what type of process Linux have. So basically Linux divide its process into two broader category. One is real-time process. So real-time process, what is a real-time process? Basically the process which have very strict deadline and the process which must not be blocked by any other low priority process during execution. And a real-time process can preempt any other process except any real-time process with a higher priority when an interrupt received and it needs to run. And another one is normal process. So basically normal process divided into two category. One is interactive process and another is batch process. So interactive process is basically a process which require more of interaction by user. So interactive process will require more interaction from user. It will wait for input and output for inputs by the user. And when an event happen, process must wake up within, for interactive process. Interactive means the process should interact with users. So like there must be a certain delay for interaction of certain delay within which the process will interact with the user after the user put some input. So that time must be within 50 to 150 milliseconds. If that time exceed 150 milliseconds, the level of interaction will definitely reduce. Another one is batch process. It don't require any, it require but very less user interaction. And it can run in background and they don't have any strict deadlines as real-time process. Don't have any strict deadlines is valid for interactive process and batch process as well. So we can also say that the normal process interactive process is basically input-output bound process and batch process is CPU bound process. It will have more burst CPU burst time. The interactive process will have more CPU input-output burst time than batch process, and batch process will have more of CPU burst time than interactive process. So there are basically three schedulers in Linux operating system. Initially it was UN scheduler from Linux 2.4 to 2.6, and another one was UN scheduler from Linux 2.6 to 2.6.22, and after that there is CFS, completely fair scheduler, from 2.6.23 to onward. So this is the base, and this is some history about the Linux scheduler. So first I would like to say something about ON scheduler. So basically ON scheduler basically choose next process for running on the CPU by computing in ON time. So what is ON means? If we let us suppose we have n processes waiting for CPU, so ON scheduler basically select a next process from that queue based upon their priorities. So it will take O n time to select a single process because the scheduler have to go through all the process and calculate its priority or see its priority and select a process with highest priority. So at every context switch, scan the list of runnable process to select the process with highest priority. Complexity of above step would be O n, as we have to compare the priority of n, and we have to find the maximum priority of n processes. So we have to look at the priority of each and every process. And also this is not scalable, because as n increases, the time which required by scheduler to select next process will also increase, and it uses a global run queue which reduces the scalability. advantages. This scheduler was better in comparison to previously used very simple scheduler based on circular queue. So it has some advantage, but it is not very good to use in nowadays because it's not scalable. Disadvantage, like if the number of processes in the ready queue is large, then the time required by scheduler to pick the next task will be significantly very high. So if we increase n, the time required by scheduler to select next process will also increase because it is O(n) process. Scalability issue, as we discussed earlier, and will take O(n) times to schedule the next process. The next processor, next scheduler is O(n) scheduler, and we can also call it as a constant time scheduler. So basically, why O(n) scheduler? Because it takes constant time to select a runnable process. So how it make this thing happen in constant time? So basically, it maintain a 40-bit bitmap in which one represent a queue with non-empty process and zero represent an empty queue or an empty index. It is also easily scalable to large number of processes because as we increase process, as we know that this is O(n) scheduler, so this will make process, this will schedule a process in constant time, so it will not take any it will not, the time required to schedule next process will not increase with number of process. It generally divided the process into two categories. So O(n) scheduler divides the process into two category. One is real time process, another is normal process. So real time process with deadlines are very strict. Okay, the process, a real time process have very strict deadlines. The priority vary from 0 to 99. User must have to assign a process as a real-time process before execution of the process so that operating system take care of the process as a real-time process. So basically, at the runtime, we can't decide which process is real-time and which process is a normal process. We have to assign a process as real-time process at the time of starting that process. Normal process, operating system will dynamically decide which process would be interactive and which would be batch. As we know that normal process basically have two category, interactive and batch process. So operating, we can't decide which process is interactive and batch. Operating system will decide on the basis of some heuristics of that process. Priorities of the normal process vary from 100 to 139, and 100 is the highest priority which a normal process can get. Scheduling of normal process. So basically, a scheduler for scheduling a normal process, scheduler maintains two queue. One is active run queue and another is expired run queue. So what is active run queue? Active run queue is a queue which maintains the process which needs to be run on, which needs CPU for execution. And the expired process, expired run queue maintains a queue in which it maintains all the process which have received a particular time quantum to execute on CPU. So the way in which the active run queue works is like the process selected from the active run queue to assign CPU, and after time bound expire, it will attach into the expired queue using the dynamic priority of the selected process. So basically, we will select the first of all, we will check the least index with non-empty queue. So basically, in this case, it will be 100. So it will select this process and assign CPU to this process. And after that, after the expire of time bound, it will put this this particular process into expired run queue based upon the dynamic priority calculated using the heuristics. Each active and expired queue has 40 priority class, 139 to 100 to 139. We have discussed this. For the normal process, the priority vary from 100 to 139. So how the scheduling policy work? So, as we discussed, I will discuss it now also. From active rank queue, it pick the first task from the lowest non-empty index from the active user active queue. Start from the lowest index, find the first non-empty index, select the first process from the queue, assign CPU to the selected process. So basically, it will select this process, assign CPU, execute this, and put back into the expired run queue. When the process time quantum expires, put the task at the end of appropriate index of the expired run queue. So, continuing on scheduling policy, after the finishing of active run queue, or once the active queue become empty, what will happen? So basically, once the active run queue become empty, this will be swapped by expired run queue. So basically, expired run queue will be named as active run queue. Sorry, and active run queue will be named as expired run queue, and the process will continue. And there is a toggling between these queues once the active queue become empty. So priority start from 0 to 139. Basically, we have 140 priority in total. Basically, 0 to 99 priority reserved for real time process. As we discussed, real time process have strict deadline, so we have to make that real time process with we have to make this real time process most prior. 100 to 139 is for normal process. Normal process will get priority from 100 to 139. Static priority. So basically, we can give the priority at the time of defining the process, or at the time of at the time of loading that process into run queue, into the new queue. So basically, initially, if we don't give any priority to the process, it will automatically get 120 as the priority. Also, we can change the default priority by using nice command in Linux. And we can make this we can use this command nice minus n capital N dot a slot a dot slash a dot out. N will range from +19 to -20. +19 means the priority will be 120 +19, and -20 means priority will be 120 -20. So the new priority will be 120 plus n. Dynamic priority. So as we discussed the use of dynamic priority, we will now discuss what is dynamic priority in details. Once the static priority is assigned to operating system to a process by operating system, once the static process priority is assigned to a process, operating system will mark the process as either interactive or batch depending upon the priority depending on the dynamic priority of the process using the heuristics of the process. So basically, dynamic priority depends totally upon the heuristic of the process. It uses a bonus to update the priority, and value of bonus depends upon the sleep time of process. So basically, dynamic priority, it depends on the bonus value of a particular process, and the bonus value of a particular process will depend totally on the sleep time of that process. Basically, an input-output bound process or an interactive process will have more sleep time, so the bonus will become more, and that is why the priority will shift toward 100 for input-output bound process. And for CPU bound process, the sleep time will be very less, so the bonus will be around 0 or 1. Bonus will also be less, so the priority will increase toward 139. So also, there is a range of dynamic priority. We can't make any process with priority less than 100 or greater than 139. If bonus is less than 5 means the process is less interactive. CPU bound process, basically the bonus less than 5 means process is CPU bound. The dynamic priority will shift toward 139. Basically, it will shift toward less parallel process. If bonus is greater than 5 means the process is more interactive, input output one process, the dynamic priority will shift toward 120, shift toward 100. What is use of dynamic priority? So basically we have discussed how dynamic priority work and what is dynamic priority now, and now we will discuss what is the use of dynamic priority. So as we discussed, the process will be selected from first non-empty queue and it will be executed and put back into the expired rent queue. But one question arises is where to put the process in this expired rent queue. So the answer is we have to put that put the process into expired rent queue based upon the dynamic priority, which we have calculated using the heuristics of the process. So basically, dynamic priority will decide in which we have to put, in which expired run queue index we have to put our process. Setting the time quantum. Time quantum is also a very precious factor in time quantum. Basically, minimum time which a process certainly get to execute in one go on CPU. Like the time quantum, that formula for time quantum is 140 minus priority into 20 millisecond for less priority, if the priority is less than 120. So basically this is for input output bound process, because input output bound process will require more time to run as it have to wait for events to happen. So it require more time quantum. And other, if the priority is less than one, greater than 120 means less prior process, the time quantum is 140 minus priority into 5 millisecond. So this is this is less as compared to this value. This is because the process with priority greater than 120 are basically batch process, which don't require any input output. It don't require much of input output, so it just use CPU burst time and it will run for that time only. The interactive process will require more time to complete as it wait more for inputs. While on the other hand, batch process will not require more CPU time because it don't require any input output. So we will get less time quantum for CPU bound process. So basically this time quantum is less because the because this is a CPU bound process, and CPU bound process will not require much of interaction. So it will run in one go. It use all its time quantum to execute. But the interactive process will not use all its time quantum to run a process. It waits for events to happen. After that, it will execute. That is why the time quantum for more priority or the time quantum for interactive process is higher than the time quantum gets for the time quantum for batch process or normal process. So now I would like to shift toward the completely fair scheduling or the scheduler also. So what is completely fair scheduler? Basically, completely fair scheduler is the best scheduler till now used by the Linux. So Linux used this completely fair scheduler since 2007. So how this completely fair scheduler came? So it is basically based on the rotating staircase deadline scheduler. It have elegant handling of input output and CPU bound process. It is default scheduling process since 6.2 Linux, since version 2.6.23 in Linux kernel. So idea behind CFS. Each runnable process have virtual time associated with it in PCB, process control block. So basically we will provide a vrun time for each process at the time of initializing that process. Whenever a context switch happens or at every scheduling point, then current running process virtual time is increased by the v increased by t. And what is t? T is the time in which the process recently execute on the CPU, or the t is the last time quantum for the running process, for the process whose virtual runtime to be updated. Runtime of the process therefore monotonically increase. So basically we have to we are basically adding some positive value to a real number, so basically it will always increases. So it will also take care of ideal fairness, that all, if there are n process in the system, each process would get 100 upon n percentage of CPU time, so that the fairness will remain equalizing all the n process. So basically how the CFS pick the next task to run. So as a CFS uses red black tree to store the process, so basically each node of this red black tree will represent a process which is waiting for running on the CPU. Like each node in the tree represent a runnable process. So here each node represent a runnable process. Nodes order according to their V runtime compared to the node on the right of the tree. Nodes are ordered according to their V runtime compared to the, basically I think there is a there is some mistake in this line. So basically we are here saying that the nodes are sorted according to their V runtime, and the node which is on the right side will have more V runtime than the nodes on the left side. And V runtime is not the time for which the process will have to run on the on the CPU. It's only a deciding factor for the deciding factor for the task to select. It is not anything which it is not the time for which the process will have to run on the CPU. This will decide on the time bound of that process, time quantum of that process. The leftmost node in the task with the least V runtime. So basically this node will have the least V runtime. So basically least V runtime is cached in the min V runtime variable. So basically min V runtime variable stores the points to the this process. So at the time of execution, the process which will execute is the process on which this min V runtime variable points. Picking the next task to run. So basically at the time of context switch, how we select the process. So we use this min V runtime pointer to select the next runnable process. And as we know, we have stored this in a variable, so we can get the next process in O1 time. So this is basically O1 operation. Like if the previous process is runnable, it would be increased, it would be inserted into the, like suppose one process we have execute and the time quantum is expired for that process. So what to do with that process? So we will basically update that the V runtime for that process, and then we put back into the in this red black tree at their appropriate position. And this can be done in O log n operation, because red black tree is self balancing tree. So the height of red black tree is some constant times log n. So basically red black tree is self balancing tree, so we don't have to worry about the this log n operation. It would be like the process of inserting and deleting is always going to be log n operation. Yeah, min V runtime points to the process with the left on the leftmost node. This is because this will have min V runtime. So why did we choose red black tree as we know the red black facial balancing tree, like no path in the tree will have twice as long as any other path. So this is a balancing tree. That is why we choose, because we have to make sure that the deletion and insertion operation will be log n. That is why we chose this red black tree. All operations are O log n operation. So log n time is good. It is scalable because it is scalable up to a certain limit. Log n operation is acceptable up to a certain limit. So that is why we choose this red black tree. This inserting and deleting task from the tree is quick and efficient because it take O log n times, which is far better than O n. And this, and we have chose this CFS scheduler because in O1 scheduler the priorities and all those things are basically dependent more on heuristics of the process. So we don't want that the priority of the process depends on heuristics. That is why we chose this because we want all process should follow a particular order, should automatically because we want equally all process to be equally fair. That is why we chose this completely fair scheduler. Okay, now we have to talk about the priority of the process, how the priority in this completely fair scheduler happens. So basically we can put some weight at the time of vrun time, at the time of initializing that process into the run queue. We can set some weight values using nice command in Linux operating system. So if a process has a run for t millisecond in the last execution, or the process have t millisecond burst time for last execution, then the vrun time updation happens in this way. Vrun time, old vrun time is equal to new vrun time is equal to old vrun time plus t into weight, where weight of the process can be set using nice value at the time of initialization of the process. So basically more weight means the process will move faster in time, and low weight means the process will not move faster in time. Lower priority implies that the time moves at faster rate compared to that of the high priority task. So what about input output and CPU bound process? What do we need? We need input output bound process should get higher priority and get a lower time to execute compared to CPU bound process. So how these things happens? So CFS achieves this efficiently because input output process have very small CPU burst time. Therefore, it will have low vrun time as we are adding. How we are updating this vrun time? We are updating by adding the burst time, CPU burst time. So if one process requires less CPU burst time, so the vrun time updation will be less for that process. So they would appear toward the left of the tree, thus they are given higher priority. And input-output bound processes will typically have larger time quantum because they have a smaller vrun time. Yeah, because they have a smaller vrun time, so they have larger time quantum. So how we add the new process to our red black tree? Basically, we whenever new process came, it will add it to the red black tree. It starts with an initial value of min vrun time. This ensures that it get to execute quickly because we are here increasing the response time for the process. So this is my representation on process scheduler in Linux. So thank you.